Now that the radio is configured, I can go through and do the other necessary settings. So the important one here is to have the unique radio ID. So this radio, I'm going to make it radio 101, and the radio name is the text that the radio will display when it's switching on. So in this case, it's a display model, so it will show the radio name. Alternatively, you can load a welcome image, so you can load a JPEG or a bitmap file into the CPS, and you can have like a company logo or something come up when the radio is switching on. So I'm just going to put a radio name. I think that's good enough for me now. So let's scroll down and let's have a look at some of the other settings here. If you were using GPS tracking, you would probably want to tick GPS. What that does is it turns on the GPS receiver and also makes the radio capable of receiving location requests. The other thing that you may want to enable is private calls. So ticking this gives the user the ability to make a private call as well as receive private calls. So there's a number of other settings over here which I'm going to skip over. There are some settings relating to alert. So various other settings here, but as far as I can see, none of them are important. Accessories, so this relates to external devices connected to the radio. There's nothing there that I want to set for now. Under buttons, I may want to set some things here, and what I like to do is I like to program some of the buttons, even though you're not using any features that would require a button. One of the things that I do like to do is to set one of the buttons on the radio to the function of manual sight roam. So if we drop on the list here, we can scroll through and find it. Otherwise, it's what's easier is just to click on it and press the letter M. And what that does, it takes you automatically to the things that start with M. If you press it again, it will come to manual sight roam. Now the other buttons, since I'm not going to be using anything else, what you can do and what a lot of people do is to turn all the buttons off. To do that, you press unassigned, you select unassigned. What I do is I just press U. So U is unassigned, there's only one thing with a U on it. So if you go through and use a tab key, you can go through and make all the buttons to be unassigned. Another button which is useful on the radio, whoops, I've taken this off, let me just put it back again, is this function here, which is called radio name. Let me get to it again. So if the user presses this button, what it will do is it will display the information that you entered over here, so the radio name and the radio ID. So it's quite useful if you pick up a radio, you want to see whose radio this is. Either you can switch it off and switch it on again, or even easier, simply press this button over here. The button settings over here, this relates to RSM that you can connect to the radio, which has got buttons on it. Here too, you'd probably want to make all of these things unassigned. We've also got the possibility of having one-touch access. So these are the things that, let's say, basically you have a button, you press that button and it will automatically set up a call or do a particular task just by pressing the button, not having to go through all the menus and get to that task. You can have a quick contact. So if you just press and hold a key on the keypad, it will automatically set up a private call or a group call to that particular contact, so not having to go through the contacts. Text messages I'm not bothered about, but here you can basically create a list of pre-programmed or canned text messages. If you're using telemetry, you could set up some settings here relating to telemetry. I will create sometime some videos giving a demonstration of how telemetry works. It's pretty nifty. You can do some cool things with it. The next thing that we want to do is to set up the menu. Now here you need to be a little bit careful because you don't want to, for example, not give certain users things, access to things like radio enable and radio disable. For the average user, let's say, it probably makes sense to turn a lot of these things off because for them it will just be an opportunity, unfortunately, to go play around with the radio. So you can turn some of these things on or you can turn them off. You can see that there's a lot of other parameters that the user can switch on and switch off from the menu. I'm going to leave it as it is. And I'm going to come to security. Now here you can set up your basically your encryption as well as the restricted access to system. So to prevent unwanted users accessing the repeater, you can set up a RAS or restricted access to system. If you're not using any privacy, you can basically set this to be none. There's no need to do anything. So this is your basically your encryption. So there are some settings here under network. This relates to text messaging, GPS, Bluetooth, external data. All of these things, I've written a blog post about it. You can go through and read what all of these things mean and what do they do. So these basically how the radio interfaces to the RF environment as well as external peripheral devices in terms of data. We're talking specifically data here. Since this is a DP4801, we have the possibility to set up voice announcements in the radio. So when the user presses a button or does a certain function, we can have the radio play a pre-recorded message so that the user doesn't have to look at the screen or anything like that. It kind of tells them what they have done. So you can set up the list here. You can also record your own voice announcements in your own language. There is included in the CPS some default files which you can use, which is like an American woman's voice, and they are there and you can use them and they're quite useful. Job tickets, this relates to the job ticketing function in the MOTOTRBO radios. So basically a job ticket is like a kind of a task that you can assign to the radio user from a PC. The user can accept that task and mark it as complete when they're done and all these sort of things. So it's a pretty useful function. We're not going to look into it now, so I'll leave it alone for the moment. The next thing that we need to look at here is down at the signaling systems. Now, you will see that there are a lot of settings here relating to, more importantly, select 5 or 5 tone. There are some settings relating to MDC 1200, quick call 2. These three things are all, let's say, analog features. So, since I'm not using any analog on this radio for now, I will just call all of them NU so that I know when I read this radio in a few months from now again, I know that NU means not used and I can skip it. So there are the three things there. We just called it NU. Now we need to set up something relating to digital emergency. For now, I'm going to leave digital emergency, the emergency mode alone, so I will just call this NU. Capacity plus we're not using, we can also call that NU. So there's nothing there that I'm using, so all of those things are called NU, makes life a lot easier. Phone patch, we're not going to use that, so I will mark that as NU. So minimize that, get it out the way. encoder, decoder. So this is the select 5 signaling part of the radio. So we have to set up sequences and telegrams. But since we are using, we're not using select 5, we can just also go through and name all of these things NU. Five tone contacts you can see marked as NU, so we're not using, so that can be hidden. The digital contacts, so we have the two talk groups over here. One thing I will say is for a group call, it's probably a good idea not to enable this call receive tone. What that will do is that whenever that group call is set up, the radio will sound an alert, and this is not maybe the nicest thing to have. The other possibility here is to add in, and if you want, you can add in a series of private calls. So these are individual radios, and you'll know that it's an individual radio because if you look at the icon next to it, it's the little square wave pulse with one little man there. So this call 1 is a radio, and it's radio ID 1. So we can call this, let's say, radio 102, for example. And then, of course, you would want to put some value in there. Now, in this case, you would want to add a call receive tone because here we want to have that the radio will ring when that radio is calling us. You can also define what type of ringer it's going to have. So what does the ring tone sound like? There's some basic tones in there. The user can, of course, change these. Next stop is capacity plus, we're not using. Phone contacts, we don't have any entries in there, so we can leave that alone. So that's now sorted. The RX group lists we've already covered in the other video, so we can minimize that. The capacity plus RX group list we're not using. The flexible RX group list, so this is a group list which the user can edit themselves. So this is more to do on capacity plus. So you will see that here there's only one entry here, NU. And if we look, where is NU here? It's under, sorry, whoops, my mistake. It's under the capacity plus context. If I even rename that, and I called it NU underscore underscore NU, you would see that if we come to the flexible RX group list, you can see it's coming up there. So it's definitely that one there. Okay, so let me just put that back to NU so we know what it is, and we can minimize that branch of the tree, so to say. The next thing that I want to do is to come to the channels once more, and there are some settings that I need to go through once more to make sure that they're working correctly. So let's go through this carefully. So if we scroll down, the first thing that we saw that we set up the roam list, so we're saying that the radio should roam using roam list talk group 1, that's fine. The color code we got from the repeater, that's color code 1, that's fine. The slot is slot 1. This is the wide area slot on which we should roam. That's fine. The phone system that we are using for telephone interconnect is set to none. We're not using phone patch, so we can leave that out. ARS, automatic registration service. So this is the presence notification that comes from the radio to notify the system that the radio is now switched on. That we can leave as disabled, we're not using it. We're not using GPS, we're not using any encryption, we're not using any restricted access to system, RAS. There is no option board in the radio. Do we want to give the user the ability to use talk around? We can switch that on, and then we need to go and set a button on the radio. What that does is allows the user of the radio, if, for example, they go outside the coverage area of the repeater, or maybe there's a power failure and the repeater goes down, they can press this talk around button. And what it does is it takes the receive frequency and makes it the transmit frequency too. So the radios are able to communicate with each other on simplex using the repeater transmit frequency. The next thing, IP side connect, this is ticked, that's fine. The next field here, this is quite interesting, and this is the per site RSSI threshold. Now, this is a relatively new feature in the radios. What this allows us to do, it allows us to define a RSSI threshold. And now, what we mean by this RSSI threshold is the roaming RSSI threshold. So the roaming RSSI threshold of this radio when it is on this site. So when the radio is on repeater 1, it should use the roaming threshold of -108 dBm. Now if you go to my blog, there are some articles about the roaming RSSI threshold and how you should set it up. Messaging delay, I don't know what happened there. Maybe there was some finger trouble. It was on 330 milliseconds. 60 milliseconds is more than enough, more than ample. So per RSSI threshold, we leave it at -108. You can change that, by the way. Messaging delay is 60 milliseconds. Compressed UDP data header, we can leave that as none. The text messaging type, you have two choices here. You either have proprietary or DMR standard. So the radio is able to send and receive text messages with older MOTOTRBO radios. And the older MOTOTRBO radios used the proprietary data format. The new way, or so to say, is a DMR standard. If you select that, what that allows you to do is allows you to send and receive text messages between MOTOTRBO radios and DMR radios from other manufacturers. So probably it makes sense to use a DMR standard, but the risk is that you have to make sure that you're not using any old legacy radios, because these legacy radios would not be able to support the DMR standard for text messaging. They'd only be able to support proprietary. So if you have a mixed fleet of what we call Generation 1 radios, so this is the DP and the DM3000 series radios, these only support the proprietary text message format, and so you would have to leave it as that. Over-the-air battery management, if you put a tick there, what that does is it tells the radio that while the radio is on this channel, it should use the over-the-air battery management protocol. Over-the-air battery management allows you to read the impress data from the battery while it's connected to the radio. So in the past, typically with impress, to get the impress data from the battery, you'd have to stick the battery into the charger. Now we can do this over the air. Okay, so this basically tells the radio, okay, use over the air battery management. Channel inhibit basically tells the radio that the channel is there in the radio, but the user cannot select it. So you can basically disable the channel. Similarly, RX only, if you tick that, what the radio will do is it will only receive on this channel. It will not transmit. So this is probably useful, I guess, in the taxi business, where the dispatcher is just giving calls out, the driver doesn't answer, or in perhaps the in area, for example, like a paramedic ambulance driver, he brings the patient into the hospital, he brings the patient to the X-ray department. When he's in the X-ray department, he's not allowed to transmit, so perhaps he can put his radio onto this channel when he's in the X-ray department, so the radio doesn't transmit it all. Coming down to the receive and the transmit parameters, so the receive frequency we've entered, the group list we've entered, then you have this setting here, the reference frequency. The best is to leave it at default. In some situations, and I've probably only seen this once in my Motorola career, you would want to change it. And basically what this does is it changes the processor clock frequency and it avoids certain intermodulation conditions or self-quietening conditions. 99.99999% of the time you'd want to leave it as default. Emergency we're not using, so we will leave these out for now. Let's come over to TX. So we've got the TX frequency, we have that came from the repeater. The reference frequency we don't need to change. The contact name we've already set, so this is the contact that the user will call when they press the PDT. So in this case he will make a call to talk group 1. Emergency system for now we will leave it at none. Vox is a voice operated transmit, and I will say that in the MOTOTRBO radios this works really well. In the old analog radios, if you sneezed into the microphone or you were talking to your friend, you would mistakenly key up the radio. So the Vox in the MOTOTRBO radios, it only keys up when you speak, not when you sneeze or bang the microphone or something like that. It only triggers the transmitter on voice. Power level. So on this channel, what power level do I want to use? I'm going to set this, we can leave it as high, that's fine. Timeout timer and timeout timer rekey delay. So this is relates to the timeout timer for the transmitter to stop the user hogging the channel or blocking the channel. A feature which is very useful in MOTOTRBO is transmit interrupt. So what we are saying here is that when this radio, if you put a tick, when this radio is on this channel, it can be interrupted. So you can break into the transmission of this radio and have the channel. Okay. So the radio can be interrupted while transmitting. Okay. I'll leave that off for now. TX interoperable frequencies. This is the same as transmit interrupt, but it basically allows the radio to be interrupted while on a simplex channel. The setting which is very important here, and a lot of people get caught by this, is the admit criteria. So in the old analog days, this was known as a busy channel lockout. So admit criteria currently is set to channel free. Now since this is a digital radio, it doesn't know what is a free channel. We have to define what is a free channel, and we do this down here in the RSSI threshold. So this RSSI threshold here is the threshold of what is a free channel. So in this case here, any signal above -124 dBm will be regarded as a free channel. Now, a lot of people add a channel and leave these two settings as they are, and it creates problems for them because the user cannot transmit on the channel because the admit criteria set to channel free, which is okay, but this RSSI threshold is set too low. -124 dBm is a very, very weak signal. So just the weakest bit of noise will cause the receiver to regard the channel as busy. So if you're going to be using channel free, you should set this RSSI threshold to a reasonably higher level. What I like to do with MOTOTRBO is I prefer actually to use this choice here, color code free. What this means is that the user can only transmit on the channel when there is no, shall we say, transmission from another radio on the same color code. So if a radio is transmitting on the channel and is using, in this case, color code 1, the radio will regard the channel as busy. If a radio is transmitting on the channel and it happens that they are using color code 2, the radio will regard the channel as free, even though there is a valid DMR transmission on the channel. So this is a very useful function for this admit criteria. In call criteria, so when the radio has set up a call, what is the TX admit criteria for that radio? So the admit criteria to set up the call is color code free. In call criteria, we can have it as always, or we can have as the same. So follow admit criteria. Or if this is a supervisor radio, you can have it set as TX interrupt. So when the user presses the PTT, he interrupts any transmission that's ongoing. So he can override any radio on the channel, provided those other radios have this allow interruption enabled. GPS revert I'm going to leave for now. So this is so basically we can have that the GPS updates are sent out on a separate channel. It frees up this channel here for voice, for purely, well, nearly purely voice. Private call confirmed is a good thing to have ticked. What this does is that if another radio calls this radio will answer back with a confirmation and acknowledgement. And this saves the channel from being busied up with a useless private call. So if you call this radio and this radio doesn't send a confirmation, then you know the radio is switched off. And the radio, your radio, which is making the call, will sound some kind of error message saying, you know, call failed or something like that. The same thing goes with for data. So the data call confirmed. So if you send a text message to the radio will acknowledge that it received the text message. So pretty useful. So now all I need to do is take all of these settings that I've defined here and I need to replicate it in the other channel, Talk Group 2. Now it's very difficult to do that when you're working like this. So what I like to do is I like to click on the zone. And if I do that, you will see now the channels are displayed in kind of a tabular format. So it's very easy to see, okay, here are all the settings for channel 1. Let's have a look at the settings for channel 2 and see how they compare. So you can see, okay, that's different. That's fine. We want that to be different. But if we scroll across here, you will see that there may be some things which need to be set. And carrying on here, let's see if we can find something. Okay, the frequencies. Yeah, the frequencies we need to set. That would need to be according to your system. Group list, that's okay. TX frequency we need to set. Contact name, emergency system, high TX power. Okay, so here we can see here something that is different and it should actually be the same. So I want to have on channel 2 the admit criteria to be color code free. So I just select that. Select that. So I'm just copying the things down. Private call confirmed. I want that to be ticked. Data call confirmed. That's okay. And we have now done the settings for channel 2. If we come to the channel that is inside the channel pool, this channel which we called site 2, we need to more or less do the same, though here it's not that important because we're not talking to anyone on, well, we are, but the radio is only going to be using these frequencies here. So let me start at the top again and go through the things that we need to set. So color code 1, slot 1, phone system, all of those things are okay. There's nothing there that I can see that needs to be changed. In the channel that's in the channel pool, so we leave the group list and the contact name, we leave them both as none. Emergency system, none. Vox, none. Power level is high. Time up time is 60. Admit criteria, we want to change that to be color code free, and the in-call criteria to be follow admit criteria. Private call confirmed is ticked. I forgot about these. Enhanced channel access. What this does is it tells the radio when you key up on the channel, you should start the transmission, quickly switch to receive to check that the channel is free and it's available for you to use, no one else is talking, and then carry on the transmission. If during this little short burst of receive it sees another signal, then the radio will stop and the call will fail, and obviously allows the other radio the chance to go ahead. So essentially, on very large IP side connect systems where you have long latencies between the extreme sites, it makes sense to have this enabled, and it prevents basically two users on the channel doubling, so talking over each other. CSBK data is a feature in MOTOTRBO which allows us to basically squeeze a data packet, for example GPS, down to the absolute minimum. So instead of using multiple time slots to send a GPS update, we break it down to one single CSBK packet. What this does in the case of GPS is it makes a huge impact on the number of GPS updates that we can achieve on a particular channel. So it's a very useful feature. So that's the channels sorted. Scan, well, scan we're not using, so I'm going to also call that NU. Roam, I've got the two roam lists, so roam talk group 1 and roam talk group 2. One thing I see that I've missed here is, if you look here at the bottom, use per site RSSI threshold. We don't want to do that. We want to use the RSSI threshold that is here, and this is set at currently minus 108 dBm. Now, if we put a tick there, we're telling the radio, okay, when you're using this roam list, you should use the RSSI, the roaming RSSI threshold that is over here. So you'll see that this one here is somehow ungrayed. And if I go to the other channel, it should be grayed. No, it isn't. Okay, you can. It's not dependent on that. So I need to take this off. And what that does, it tells the radio, okay, when you're using this roam list, you should use this RSSI threshold. The one that's in the channel, so basically putting a tick and using the one that's in the channel, is particularly useful if you have sites which have varying coverages. So if you have a site which is on top of a huge mountain with a big mast and it provides a massive coverage, you'd probably want to use a different RSSI threshold in comparison to the others, which may not be on such an ideal site. Otherwise, you simply use this one here. Looking at the other roam list, that's okay. Everything seems to be okay there. Then, looking at Capacity Plus, I'm not using anything in Capacity Plus for now, so I will leave all of these things as NU.